Welcome to AI 101, where we learn about the core concepts that underlie the systems we call artificial intelligence. This month, we're not talking about an algorithm at all. Instead, we're talking about data. Data collection, data labeling, how to create a good data set, and why that's a lot harder than you might think. If you're new here, welcome, and subscribe to keep learning about more AI. You can also follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook to learn more about my PhD student life. Okay, let's get started. Data is important. Like, really, 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 really important. The title of this video is not an exaggeration. Without data, we wouldn't have AI systems. In fact, many of the scandals that we've seen around AI systems weren't caused by the models themselves, but by issues in the data set. And yet, it's a really underrated topic, in my opinion. This has a lot to do with the fact that creating and improving data sets is a very human task. Somebody has to sit down and really work with the data. And in a world of AI hype, human labor isn't sexy. In any case, before we can train a model, we need to create a dataset. This occurs in three major steps: data collection, data cleaning, and data labeling. Before we get into it, there's a great paper that's going to be the main reference for this video. I'd highly recommend checking it out. It's kind of long though, so bear in mind. How do we collect data? In most cases, we'll start by looking for existing data that could be used to solve our problem. Depending on the problem, there may be a nice, large, formatted data set that's perfectly suited to your needs, available somewhere on the internet already. In all seriousness, we've talked in past videos about how AI's rise in the early and mid-2000s has a lot to do with the fact that we were just collecting so much more data than we had been in the past. So while the perfect data set might not be out there, there's a pretty good chance that there's some public or private data set that would suit your needs, at least to get you off the ground. For example, if you wanted to make a model that classified YouTube videos by genre, you might start with the YouTube-8M data set, a set of YouTube videos that have been collected and labeled by Google. It's publicly available and you can download it as long as you have the space for it. Similarly, if you're a researcher who is looking to classify patient data, you might see if your lab or your institution has a data sharing agreement with a research hospital. This is actually how I did my research at Stanford. We had a data sharing agreement with Stanford Children's Hospital, and so that was how I got my MRI data. Unlike the YouTube dataset though, this is privately available data, so any do-it-yourself, self-taught developer wouldn't have access to this kind of data set. Okay, but what if there isn't any data but that's publicly available that solves your problem? Well, that means that you're going to have to come up with it yourself. There are a lot of different ways of doing this, and your approach will largely depend on the problem that you're trying to solve and the type of data that you think is best suited for it. So I'm not going to get into the specifics of that because there's literally thousands of ways of doing this. For example though, suppose we're developing a model that aims to predict how long it's been since I've worn a particular item of clothing in my closet. In this case, items in my closet are not publicly available data, so we'll have to go to my closet and take a look at what items are there. You might also use crowdsourcing to collect data. Amazon's Mechanical Turk is a popular platform for this, where people can sign up to complete tasks and then receive payment for it. You can also look into citizen science, where you engage the public in data collection, which helps you collect more data, but also helps the public learn more about the science that you're trying to do. Okay, we have some data, but we either don't have enough data or there's some issue with the data that makes it difficult for us to use. This is where most people will find themselves after that initial round of data collection. What do we do now? Well, there's a bunch of different paths that you can take from here. If you don't have enough data, you might go back to the data collection step and find more. This is particularly important if certain groups are underrepresented in your data set. Alternatively, you might synthesize new data using GANs or generative adversarial networks. We've talked about these models in the past, but essentially you can use them to take existing datasets and create new data that looks like your old dataset did. In fact, there are startups that are now touting the use of GANs to create more diverse sets of stock photos, which is either good or kind of problematic, depending on how you think about it. You can also augment the data that you already have. Some basic steps might include rotating or flipping your images when developing an image classifier. In this way, you're collecting more data without having to actually go out and get more data. If you do have enough data, but either the quality of the data isn't that great or there's issues with the formatting, then we'll move on to the next step of data cleaning. This is where we might filter or crop images to remove objects and noise that are unwanted, reorganize information into data structures that are easier to use, or otherwise alter the data to better suit our needs. Ideally, cleaning the data should not result in a data set that's no longer representative of the population that you're looking to study. In other words, you can clean too much. Okay, we've got enough data to have a representative data set. It is clean, it's in the right format. Time to throw down model, right? Maybe. The answer to this question depends on whether you're using supervised learning or unsupervised learning. If you need a refresher, you can check out the unsupervised learning and supervised learning AI 101 videos. But in short, unsupervised learning doesn't require your data to be labeled, whereas supervised learning does. It also depends on whether the data that you collected already has the labels you need. If you're using patient health records to predict one vital sign from another, chances are you already have the labels intrinsic in your dataset. On the other hand, if I still want to predict how long it's been since I wore something in my closet, I probably have to go through and label each individual item. The process of labeling can be both very subjective and also very labor-intensive, so this is another place where we might see the use of crowdsourcing and citizen science. One of the labs that I worked with at Cornell actually created a game for this specific purpose called Stall Catchers. People win points and make their way up the leaderboard by identifying stalled blood cells in brain images. In this way, the people who are playing the game feel more involved in the research, and the lab is able to cut down their data collection time from months to weeks. Once you've made it through the labeling, you're probably ready to try your data set out on your model. But this probably isn't the end of the line for data collection. Training your model can reveal some issues that may negatively impact the outcomes that you're trying to predict or classify, and often these issues can be traced back to the dataset itself. In that case, you may need to return back to the data collection, data cleaning, or data labeling drawing board to figure out how to make a better AI system. That's it for this month's AI 101. Was there anything about the process of building a dataset for an AI system that surprised you? Let me know in the comments. If you like this video, you can let me know by smashing that like button and subscribing to my channel. You can also support me on Patreon. Thank you so much to all of my current patrons. Otherwise, you can find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye.